So, before ending the lesson, let's take a moment to think back on what we just saw. We started the lesson with a discussion of the sustainability between natural resources on one side and manufactured capital on the other, and we related the attainability of an economically sustainable development with the level of their elasticity of substitution, which is how much their employment ratio change when its price ratio change. If this is high, it will be easier to attain a sustainable development compared to a case where this is low or even zero. We then started a positive approach to the problem, that is, we suggested what the society should do in order to achieve a sustainable development that also maximizes the welfare. We initially formulated the welfare maximization as a single period problem, finding that the marginal contribution to the social welfare from each person in the society must be the same. Well, we saw the case for just two individuals, but we can easily extend these results to multiple ones. We arrived at these results using the so-called Lagrange multipliers method, where our objective function is augmented by each constraint by a factor formed by an additional dummy variable, that we call the Lagrange multipliers, and the constraint itself. We reviewed this method extensively. We then moved to a multi-period analysis, where we stylized our world as a simple economic system that uses natural resources R and manufactured capital K to produce a single good Q that can be either consumed C and hence produce utility U, or it can be added to the capital stock K to produce more output in the future. We put ourselves on the point of view of a benevolent dictator that can choose the level of consumption C and natural resources extraction R in each moment in time, and this is why these two variables have a time index, to maximize the total welfare across all generations. We approached this problem with a technique called optimal control theory that has some strong parallelism with the Lagrange multipliers method, but where the additional dummy variables, but here they are known as the co-state variables, are themselves functions of time rather than being simple scalars like in the Lagrange multiplier method. We obtained two important results. At the optimal level, at each moment in time, the marginal benefits related with a choice variable must be equal to the marginal cost, and we call this static efficiency conditions. Using an output for consumption rather than adding it to the capital stock generate a marginal benefit in terms of utility, that is U little c, but we give up the value that such output would have as a part of the capital stock, that is omega, the shadow price of capital. The other static efficiency conditions is that extracting an additional output of the resource generate a marginal benefit, either in terms of value of the additional capital stock that can be produced, marginal product Q little r multiplied by omega, or equivalently in terms of utility from the consumption, marginal product Q little r, but this time multiplied by the marginal utility of consumption U little c. But we give up its marginal value as the resource in situ, its shadow price P. In addition, at equilibrium, each asset of a resource, here a natural resource or capital stock, must earn the same rate of return, and this must remain constant in time and equal to the social discount rate, and we call this, if you recall, dynamic efficient conditions. The first one is that natural resource stock value, measured using the shadow price of the resource in C2P, must grow at the social rate of discount rho. This rule is known as the Hotelling rule, a very important result in natural resource economics. The second dynamic efficiency condition we found is that the overall return of the capital stock, its increasing value from its shadow price omega, plus the additional marginal productivity that such capital stock holds, Q little k, must be again equal to the social rate of discount rho. While we found these results analytically, we also derived them using the flowchart presented in the lesson, under the assumptions of efficiency in the choice of the control variables. It has been a long and deep lesson. The next lessons will build up on top of this framework, adding a bit of concreteness to what may appear now as something vague and too much theoretical.